Falco is basically a badass tyrant who commands the whole city of Obsidian, and Sloane is his lovely wife.
Yeah, and if they've actually, they're at that point in the relationship, which I think is really realistic for a lot of the audience that are coming to see this show, where their daughter is turning 18 and she's about to leave home, and it's that kind of thing where you look at each other and go, oh yeah, who are you again, and why are we together? And so through Act 2, they kind of have to figure that out. So it's a really realistic, I suppose, relationship set in a really crazy world.
Yeah, a roller coaster, basically.
Yeah.
Of emotions. Uh-huh. As I've heard from Jim and Jim's team, the songs were written originally for theatre, and I think that comes across first class, that these songs were longed for the stage, and finally, after 40 years, they have made it.
Definitely.
And as Jim wrote us all tonight, his dream has come true.
Yeah. Like, one of the songs we sing is Paradise by the Dashboard Light, which is like, it's like a mini play. Like, it actually is. There's like three acts to it. So like, as Rob said, it's already there. So it's just to have songs that rich as a performer, as well as a script like this to perform, is a gift completely.
What stops the anxiety for me is the fact that we created this choreography together with trust. And we were given free rein, and our director said, whatever you feel comfortable with, and is safe, and both Sharon and I, with the choreography, we tried stuff out, and if it didn't work, we threw it in the bin. And so it's really,
and our choreography is important to say that it was, because we didn't have the car.
We had
two tables
which weren't
and
joined
four chairs
together.
Which weren't joined together in a room when everybody else is doing everything else, going right. So how are we going to do this? But it works.
Yes, no seats,
really no
dashboard lights.
But you know what, that show is like, or that number in particular, because it's so technical and there's so much going on in it. Like, we've got cakes and you've got a car and you've got windscreens, you've got everything.
And we have to strip.
Yeah, and we have to strip. It's one of those numbers where it's like, you just don't know what's going to happen. Every night we kind of go out front and we just kind of
do a high five
and are like,
yeah,
Yeah.
It's like a relay race.
And we just hope
you just have to keep passing the baton and
hope the best. Are you lucky to have somebody out there that if you fall?
It astonishes me always, because people are saying, oh wow, your chemistry, and it's so intimate, and there's so much sex appeal there.
It's because we're terrified.
It's exactly what it is, which I think two barely 17-year-olds would be terrified. Tension.
It was definitely a challenge to begin with, because while we've both done bits of television, our main thing is theatre and musical theatre for me, and you're so used to performing out and putting your guts out there on a stage, especially when you're singing through music, because it's that kind of heightened drama and storytelling. So to then all of a sudden have to shrink down and remember that you're acting for television or for camera work, is it's so different. So it was a real challenge, but we have a director with an incredible eye, and Jay Scheib is just, he gets it, and he's guided us through it so well. It would feel weird to do the show now without us. Do you know what I mean? It's become kind of part of our bodies.
Yeah, I think the thing that Jay, one of the tips that he gave me is he said that you have to remember this has been going on for many, many years. It's not just happening now. So a lot of the stuff where the camera's being used, we have to understand that these arguments, and it's not the first time an argument or a situation of this kind has happened. It's been going on for years and years. So they have to be as grounded as possible, as arguments can be, because you've been through every scenario already. And everything else is just about blocking and being ready for a camera angle to, I don't know, just
showing I know my
to give your
angle.
Juxtaposition in the correct moment like that. Well, for me, I have to put my hand up high in having a wonderful musical supervisor like Mike Reed and a wonderful vocal coach, Fiona McDougall,
is a
huge help. And that's why for shows like this, I'm sure in many shows you have a heavy rehearsal period, but we had a hardcore army recruit center rehearsal period.
It was like training, though, wasn't it? It is like training for a marathon. Like, it really is. It's totally about getting the stamina. And it's funny because we all take different songs throughout the show. And then it makes me wonder, like, you look at somebody like Meatloaf and you go, he would have sung them all mm-hmm. in one night, in one gig. And how does he do that? That's incredible. Like, that is, it is a marathon. And
apparently
a half.
He had oxygen on the side of the stage.
I
can understand that.
Definitely. We should ask for that.
Yes.
We should ask for that. Jackie, can we get some oxygen?
I mean, I feel that they're so timeless is because they met by chance. Mm. And Jim was auditioning for a play, and Meatloaf walked in, and he was the typical... Meatloaf was pretty well stocked back then, and Jim said, with that emotion and that drama that he brings to a song, why shouldn't this big guy be the leading man? And that's the trust in just a human being, which Jim had towards Meat, is just tremendous. And I think that's why they stuck together, because they had trust in one another and what they had to offer.